Hey, welcome to Taylor's Trick Taking Table. I'm Table, and today we're going to be covering Cat in the Box. It's a game by Muneyuki Yokauchi. And earlier in Japanuary, we covered dogs, so I thought it was only fair to cover cats. And as you can see by a third of my intros, there is a giant cat here. So I love cats, from big to small, to even my favorite cat here, Sueño, which is totally here. They're definitely there. I don't know where else. What? Oh, they've been in this box all day? Sueño, my favorite cat, has been in a box all day. Oh, no. If Sueño's here and Sueño's there, then this is a cat paradox. Oof. Looks like we kind of caused a cat paradox there. So the only way out of it is you have to learn about the hook to Cat in the Box. So players can choose the suit of the card they're playing, because all the cards just have numbers on them, not suits. So players can say this is a red 4 or a yellow 3. However, if players get themselves into weird binds and push their luck and say they couldn't have played a suit that they actually could have, they might cause paradoxes. Let's go to the table and I'll show you how to play. The deck in Cat in the Box is made up of 40 suitless cards numbered 1 through 8, and there are 5 copies of each number in the deck. In a 4-player game, you'll include the 7 and the 8 cards. Here we have a game set up for 3 players. So you have the research track, where players will denote which cards they've played through the course of the hand. Then you have the start player marker, which goes to the last player who saw a cat. Then you have bid cards, where players will bid and also say which suits they're out of. Then each player will get 10 cards and a bunch of their tokens. Hey, this is Editing Taylor Later, and I forgot to include that during setup, players actually look at their 10 cards and they'll choose one to go into the discard next to the research track. So after players have done that, then they will bid, which you'll see next. But I forgot to include that, so just imagine in all the gameplay examples, everyone has one less card. So starting with the lead player, they'll look at their cards and they'll bid on how many tricks they think they're going to win for the hand. Let's say, because they have sixes and a couple fives, maybe Black Cat here thinks they're going to win 3. And so then coming over to the Lion Cat, looking at their hand, they have a lot of twos. Maybe they're not too confident, and they bid just 1. Then finally, coming over to Sueño here, they have 3 sixes and a 5. Maybe they think they're going to win 4. So after everyone's bid, then the lead player will play a card and declare what suit it is to the trick. So how it works is, you can play a card and declare a suit as long as it's not covered here, or you can't play a red until it's been played before, and I'll explain that in a little bit. Red is kind of like the trump in this game. The cat here will lead, and let's say they play a 6. So when they play the 6, they'll declare what suit it is. Let's say Black Cat here played a 6 blue. So they'll take their token, they'll put it on a 6 blue, and they can either just say they played 6 blue or put a token and it's kind of clear, or they can take these optional cards here, which is pretty helpful, and just put like a corner there and say 6 blue to kind of help everyone know. This is just optional, but kind of helps everyone know what suit was just played. So then it goes to Lion Cat. And looking at their hand here, they can play any card that hasn't been covered yet. So they couldn't play this 6 blue, because that's already been a card that's been played. So the 6, they could play and say it was a 6 yellow or a 6 green. It's a little bit risky, and I'll cover that in a little bit. But instead, they just kind of played a little safer and play this 2 blue. So they're following suit with a 2 blue, and I guess they could totally use that as well. And they'll take one of their tokens, and they'll put that on the 2 blue. So then coming to Sueño here, they will just play 3 blue. So they'll grab one of theirs. Maybe they don't want to use the player aid, so that will end the trick, and whoever plays the highest of the lead will win it. So Black Cat here will take this trick and now put it right there, and they've won one trick. So then they will lead the next trick. So now Black Cat, if they want to lead again, they can't play any of the reds because no one has played to the red before. And how you can play to the red is if you're forced to play to the red. But as you can see here, there's a lot open, so Black Cat here is not forced to play red yet. So they decide to just play 5, and then they could say, you know, yellow, blue, or green. maybe they want to win more tricks, so they say blue. So they'll say five, blue, and then it will go to the Lion Cat. Coming over to Lion Cat, looking at their hand, they could follow suit and play this one and say it's blue. However, maybe they don't want to do that and wanted to do something a little bit different. Maybe they say two, yellow. And so they would take their token, they'd put it onto yellow, and then since it was lead blue and they didn't play blue, meaning they're off suit and they can't play blue, they will say, I don't have any blue. And so this is kind of starting off, I guess they're lying, so we'll add this lying pin. That will start off this possible paradox here, because if later in the course of the game, if these are still out and Lion Cat is forced to play this one and have it be blue, they'll create a paradox and that will end the round, end the hand right away. But we'll get to that if that ever happens. So then coming to Sweeney over here, they have this one, this four, this three. So they could play this four, say it is blue. So they're still in suit. And then the winner, again, would be Black Cat. They collect the trick and lead the next trick. So I think now is a good time to talk about why someone would lie and maybe kind of push their luck on causing a paradox, because, FYI, causing a paradox is very bad. You get minus points, it's a whole thing, it's not good. So why would they lie? If you look over here, notice how players are putting down tokens and these are all kind of next to each other, right? So at the end of the game, if you hit your bid, you will get extra points for a contiguous block, the biggest contiguous block you have. So just throwing these out here, say this was closer to the end of the game here. If this is how it looked and Black Cat had hit their bid and not caused a paradox, they would get three extra points because you get a point per trick. Then if you hit your bid and didn't cause a paradox, you would get extra points up here. So if this was like this even, they would get five extra points, including the three, because they'd need three tricks to hit their bid. So this up here is kind of, I don't know what to call it. It's not like really area control or anything. It's just kind of like a spatial-ish situation where you want a lot of tokens next to each other. So in that last trick, when Lion Cat lied and they said they didn't have a one or four or didn't want to play a one or four in blue and played a two yellow, is because now they have two tokens next to each other. So if they do hit their bid of one trick, they'll get these 2 points here because now they're next to each other, and maybe they're trying to get a lot of their tokens around here and kind of grouped together. So I'll remove these and we'll go back to the trick taking. Back to the third trick here. So the Black Cat wants to win three and they're not quite sure if they're going to win many of the rest. So maybe they play their five. And looking over here, since red hasn't been broken yet and they're not forced to play red, they can choose between yellow and green five. So let's say they say yellow five. Coming to Lion Cat, they could, if they really wanted to win it, they could say any of these numbers in red and just say they have trump. But to do that, they'd also have to say they don't have a yellow, which is super risky. So maybe they're just gonna follow suit for now and play their six yellow. And then they would put a token there. And then coming to Cat, now they're nervous because they have to win four. So then they look at theirs and they notice they are near the three and the four on the red track. So they can say they don't have any yellow and say this is red. So they said they played a red three. So now since they played a red three, they've trumped because it's highest in trump. And if no trump, highest in lead. So they'll take this trick and they'll lead the next trick. They do have to put a token on don't have yellow because it was lead yellow and they played red, meaning they didn't have any yellow. With Sueño leading here, since red has been played, they now can lead red, unlike before. So maybe they lead with a six red. They would put their token on six red. And then now players have to follow suit in red. So maybe Black Cat here plays, oh, they can't play a three red. They can play a four red. Though, boop, and then Lion Cat would play possibly a five red, which is super interesting because now trump is a pretty blocked off section here. And so highest trump would win, so Sueño would win again. And then let's jump forward now to maybe later in the round when paradoxes might start happening. Jumping ahead to the final trick here, it's Lion Cat's lead, and they only have the one, two, and the five. Since they said they don't have any blue, they can't play this one because they don't have any blues. So since two's all fixed, they can only play this five. So they play the five and they say it's a five green. And now it's Sueño's turn. There are no more fives to be played, so they can only play this six. And the only six left is green. So they say six green. And they play their final card. And then coming to Black Cat here, they only have the one. So one blue is what they're forced to play, and they say one blue. So the winner would be Sueño with the highest of the lead suit, and they'd win this trick. If that isn't quite how it went, say that it was coming to Black Cat, and this was the only one left, and they had that one from earlier. If they couldn't play to the final trick because they didn't have a two at all, they would cause a paradox. And so I'll go into how that's bad in scoring, but in the trick playing, if a paradox happens, no one gets that trick. And the second it happens, you stop putting tokens on. You'd still keep the tokens on from the earlier people who played to the trick, but that trick is done and that hand is over. Now we're at final scoring for the hand, and how it works is every player that didn't cause a paradox gets a point per trick, no matter what. So 2, 3, and 3. Then if you hit your bid, which the only person who hit their bid was the Black Cat, you get the area bonus. So you look at your biggest contiguous touching area and you get points per token. So if they're E here, they had a two grouping, but they had this three grouping. So they would get 3 points for a point per trick, and then 1, 2, 3 for hitting their bid and then having a three grouping. If, unfortunately, Lion Cat, they got two tricks. But if they got one trick, they'd look over and they would have 4 bonus points. Similarly, if Sueño hit their bid, they would have gotten 3 bonus points. If, however, in that one example, when they only had the one and the two was gone, and Black Cat caused a paradox, you actually get minus point for every trick you got if you caused a paradox, and you don't get any bid bonus at all. So instead of getting 3 points plus the three for hitting their bid, if Black Cat caused a paradox, they would have gotten -3 points. After counting the points, the round start player would go to the next player, cards would be shuffled, and tokens would be returned to each player. You would play rounds equal to the number of players, so 2 more rounds, and then whoever has the highest points wins. If it's a tie, you look at whoever got the highest points in the last round, and if that's a tie, then it's shared victory. There's also a variant way to play, where you flip these over, and it's pretty similar, it's just that each of the 4 suits are offset, which makes the kind of area control adjacency really interesting. And that is Cat in the Box. What a lovely, wild game. It's funny because right from the bat, you can tell, maybe right from the cat is probably a better phrase, you can tell that a lot of thought went into this game, just from the graphic design even. The cards, the tokens, everything looks great. I think the fact that they even include an optional card that helps players know what suit is played is just, it's such a thoughtful game from that aspect. But the gameplay itself is super thoughtful too. I think it starts with the bidding and the fact that you can't bid higher than a certain number. You're pigeonholed into these 3 bids. So at 4 players, you can't go over 3, and then at 3, you can't go over 4. So it's really interesting because if you get a super strong hand, if there wasn't that bid limiting, you could just run the table, you know? And so the fact that you have to kind of reel yourself in or hold yourself back a little bit really helps. You're really spreading tricks out in this game. And the fact that every trick's a point is really important, or a negative point if you lose it. So the fact that the tricks usually will always be spread out pretty well helps this game so much. The game flows really well because once players get their hands, they're looking at it and bidding not only how many tricks they're going to win, but they're also looking at where they're going to be on that research track. So you know that if you have a lot of like 2s and 3s or something, you might be in this section and you're kind of trying to plot out when you should maybe lie and so you don't have a color and try to finesse that area part of the game when you're on the track. I actually think the other side of the track where the cards are, or sorry, where the numbers aren't fully up and down, but actually slanted, is super interesting. It's super interesting because you can kind of know that the green suit, the ones on the green suit are super separated. So if you play the one on the green, you really need to play two of the green to kind of connect the one on the green. So it makes the suits stand out and be a little bit different as opposed to kind of all the same a little bit. So I think this is my favorite way to play. And at player count, I think I like three, maybe a little bit more. So at four, you play where the bid is one, two, or three. But at three, you can't bid two. It's one, three, or four. And just that small gap, it seems really not important, but it makes such a big difference. If you have like a hand that you're like, I'm pretty sure this is a two trick hand, you have to either push yourself for three, maybe to get a little bit more points, or see if you could really slough off and hold back. It's a really cool fact that they didn't just do one, two, three or something like that. One thing I've noticed, and I don't think it's a con of the game, it's just something that maybe I just need to wrap my head around, is when the paradox happens, it's brutal. It could happen on other players' turns and maybe even through no fault of their own, but it could just screw over your bid. So you'll be hoping to get your number and everything's mathed out and you're on the last trick and everything's going to work out. And then it just collapses and you don't get your bid. And it feels a little defeating. It's almost like in Skull King, where someone has, in the expansion of Skull King, where someone has like the Kraken card and everyone bids thinking, you know, perfectly. And then someone plays the Kraken and then everyone's off by one. So that can feel a little defeating, but I think I just really need to get into the mindset of this game where paradox is going to happen, and that might be part of the strategy, right? If you can pigeonhole people into creating paradoxes while you have your bid hit, you can really mess over the other players. I love the deck makeup. I love that you can only play four of each number, but there's five in the deck. So when you get dealt something like this with three of a number, like I have these three twos, I'm very nervous, and I really want to always be playing the two of all the suits, because being stuck at the end with two of the number and you might get forced to create a paradox is a very nerve-wracking feeling. And my favorite part of this game is choosing when to lie and choosing when to say that you don't have a certain color. When you do it where there's really only one number of that color left, it's not like the biggest lie and you can really get away with it. But when you do it when there's like three or maybe four of that color left, you're really pushing it, and it's such a tense feeling when you do that. And then if it pays off, you're just like, whew. You know, you feel like you slid under the closing door or something, or the closing box. And that is Cat in the Box, and I really love this game. I think I was expecting to, just because the same designer did Yo-Kai Septet, which I really, really like. And it's interesting because this game has some kind of, maybe just in the group I play in, but some kind of rote kind of flows. If someone's leading and they have good hands, they'll probably play a lot to try to just win the tricks they need to win. But I think by trick three or four, it starts to get a little spicy. People are lying, things are getting a little hairy, and this game has such a climax to the round that I think it has a great game arc and just a hand arc. So I think this deserves the seal. So, and thanks so much for watching.